Watching mind and ego. Ego is an aspect of the mind, but specifically in order to emphasize on mind and ego, I have chosen to address as watching mind and ego. A meditator enters into his mind and starts watching how the mind functions. Indeed, a meditator, when the process of meditation begins, he enters into his mind and starts watching how the mind functions, the various aspects, the four corners of the mind, the ego, the memory, the intellect, and the mind itself, that aspect of the mind that coordinates the activities of the memory, the ego, and intellect together. Although mind is used as in the wider sense as well as to refer to that mechanism that coordinates the activities of all these, just the very fact of watching the mind makes him aware that he is not the mind. He is not anything that belongs to the mind. I see, nose smells, tongue tastes, skin touches, the ears hear, but you are not the ears. You are sum total of everything, aggregate. You are not the eyes, but you see through the eyes. Then who is this you? Who is this I? I see through the eyes, but I am not the eyes. I hear through the ears, but I am not the ears. I speak through the tongues, but I am not the tongue. I smell, but I am not the smell. That means the smelling and that who smells are two different. Witnessing makes you aware of that. Watching makes you aware of that. Just the very fact of watching the mind makes him aware that he is not the mind. He is not anything that belongs to the mind. He is not any of the sense organs that belong to the mind. Is faraway entity, qualitatively different, just a pure watching. In other words, just a pure mirror which only reflects the reality but is not imprinted by any reality. Just pure watching. In other words, just a pure mirror which only reflects the reality but is not imprinted by any reality. If the ugly face comes in front of it, without any judgment, it shows the ugly face in its full details. Without any condemnation, without any judgment or anything. And when the beautiful face appears, again there is no appreciation and no evaluation either. This is witnessing. It shows the ugly face of the beautiful face with the same detached, faraway, reflecting witnessing. This is you are watching. And the famous statement of Jesus, judge ye not that ye not be judged. This statement can only happen when you are simply a mirror and you are watching. Unprejudiced. The moment you become a witness, there will be no need to leave your ego outside the gate. Because now you can see that this is the ego functioning. It has its function, it has its utility as far as the world is concerned, the outer world. But when it comes to the inner world, ego has no use, no place. In fact, ego will have left you. Even if you run after it, you cannot catch hold of it. So the right process has to be understood. The ego is not something like your umbrella or your shoes or your raincoat that you leave outside the gate. Ego is hidden inside your mind. It is one aspect of the mind. Or if we divide mind into four quadrants, then ego sense, that is in Hindi it is called ahankar, then memory, we live by the memory. Anytime any thought comes, any situation comes, it you go back to the memory, and then from there the decision comes, then intellect. And that quadrant that coordinates the activities of all the three and comes to the final judgment. These are the four quadrants. Ego is hidden inside your mind. But more precisely, it is one quadrant, one corner of your mind. Of course, you cannot leave your head outside. And the ego comes along wherever you go. The ego has to be understood. In that understanding, it disappears. Only a witness knows that the ego is a false entity. The mind cannot know, the ego sense cannot know, the intellect cannot know, the memory cannot know. It is only in the moments of witnessing you will come to realize that ego is a false entity and you need not fight with anything that is false. Erroneously, we go on saying that we are fighting with ego. No, it is like saying that they are fighting with imagination, fighting with something which does not exist. Do you ever fight with darkness? Do you ever fight with darkness? When you find darkness in your room, do you struggle? You take out your gun, you take out your sword or anything else to throw it out or to destroy it? Do you wrestle with it? Do you start taking out your sword to cut off the head of the darkness? If you do any such stupid things, you will simply show your unintelligence. And for that matter, you are not unintelligent. You will not be able even to touch it, the darkness that is in your room. You cannot throw darkness into the neighbor's yard because it is not tangible. So too, ego is not tangible. With the negative, nothing can be done directly. If you want to do anything with the negative, do something for the positive. When you do not want darkness in the room, what you do? You bring the light inside. This is bringing the positive, the other pole into the light, limelight, onto the surface. Darkness is one pole which is negative, the other pole is positive pole is light. You bring light into it. You do not bother about darkness. Your whole approach is totally different. You bring light in, and the moment the light is in your room, you cannot find darkness anymore. You do not have to fight to remove darkness. The moment you bring witnessing is the light that you bring into the mind. And the moment you bring the witnessing into your mind, the watching into the mind, you will find the ego loses its hold on to you. The same is true about your ego. It has no existence of its own. It is a false substitute that has been given to you so that you can go on playing with it and completely forget the search for the real self. Demands of this false ego are immense and are never fulfilled. It demands money, it demands power, it demands respect, and you go on fulfilling it, but it will always remain empty, seeking something else. It is like the desire that are never fulfilled. You fulfill one desire, the next takes birth immediately. You cannot make an egoist contented. The ego is always like an open wound. It goes on growing bigger and bigger and bigger and remains oozing always. The moment you try to fill it, the more you find it, it is empty, and the more demanding it becomes. You become almost a slave to a false entity. Your whole life is wasted in ambitions created by ego. Your whole life is wasted in ambitions created by ego. The ego is the most dangerous invention that society has managed to create. Remember, it is an invention of the society. Ego is the most dangerous invention that society has managed to create. And when you want to drop, never think in terms of dropping it. Because even the word drop gives you the idea that it is something tangible. It is nothing in reality. You cannot drop it because it is not tangible. You cannot put it out of the door. You have to look into the reality of it. In deep meditation, you have to become a witness to all the functionings of the mind, the ego, the memory, the intellect. In deep meditations, you have to become a witness to all the functionings of the mind, because the ego is the combined byproduct of your mind's functioning. Its thoughts, its desires, its ideologies, its prejudices, its politics, its philosophy, its religion, everything contributes in some way or the other to create a certain ego sense in you. Osho has mentioned one of his professors, Dr. Das. I would like to put it in his words. I had a professor, Dr. Das, a very famous philosopher, not only in India, but in almost every country. He had been teaching around the world, and he had come back to India, to his home, just to retire. He was my teacher for only 3 months. After those 3 months, he went into retirement. But those 3 months were of great revelation to me and to him. The first day when he entered the classroom, I was sitting in his chair. He looked so embarrassed, standing by my side, and I was so relaxed in the chair. The students started laughing and said, "What is going on?" I said, "Nothing is going on. I find this chair more comfortable than the other chairs. And I am not a stupid student. I can choose what is right for me." He said, "You seem to be a very strange person. This chair is for the teacher." I said, "Then there is no problem. I will teach. What is the problem? If the chair is for the teacher, then the teacher is sitting in it. You can find some other chair and sit down." He was an old man, a world famous philosopher, and his ego was immensely hurt. He said, "You do not understand with whom you are talking." I said, "I understand perfectly well. You do not understand with whom you are talking." But I did not leave this chair. I told him that whatever he wants to do, he can do. He can go to the vice chancellor. He can bring the vice chancellor. I am going to remain in this chair. He said, "What is the purpose of all this mess?" I said, "The purpose is to show you that it is not my sitting in the chair that is hurting you. It is your ego. If you accept it, I will leave the chair. If you do not accept, then you can bring anybody to help you. But as far as I know, the students, nobody is going to help." He waited a minute. There was utter silence in the class. Everybody is afraid that if vice chancellor comes or the proctor comes, there is going to be trouble for me. They would immediately expel me. I had already been expelled from so many places, but I always continued to do strange things. What was the need to sit in his chair? But the Dr. Das was certainly an intelligent man. He did not go out. He said, perhaps you are right. It is my ego that is hurting. It is not a question of chair. I said, then I leave it. But remember, before you retire, you have only 3 months more in this university. It will be good if you retire, but do not take your ego away with you. Leave it here in this chair for somebody else to use. I left the chair, and he was in such confusion that he told his students, today it will not be possible for me to teach. And to me he said, I would like you to come to my house. I want to discuss some important matters with you. He was an unmarried man. He had written many beautiful books, and before encountering him, I had read everything that he had written. He took me in his car to his home. On the way, he said, I am sorry that I did not understand your purpose. You are the first man in my life who has pointed out my ego. I certainly have a very big ego, and it went on becoming bigger and bigger as I became more and more respected in the world of philosophy. You will have to help me to get rid of it. I am also feeling the torture of it. I am also feeling the burden of it, but I do not know what to do with it. He had never thought about meditation. Philosophers never meditate. Make sure, they may say that they are meditating, they talk about meditation, but they never meditate. Their whole approach to life is intellectual. They think about and about everything, including meditation, but never become a witness to any experience, particularly the experience of their inner thought process. If you really want to get rid of ego, you have to go so deep into your meditations that you can create a distance between you and your mind. This is what Shankar said. I am neither the mind, nor the ego sense, nor the intellect, nor the mind process. Mano buddhi ahankar chittani naham. Neither of these I am. Neither I am the air that I breathe, nor the 5 sheets I am. Beyond all that, if you really want to get rid of your ego, you will have to go deep into your meditations, that you can create a distance between you and your mind. What does it matter if people say something that I am sane or insane, I am ugly or good looking? It does not touch me. It touches the ego sense. And when you are beyond that, these things do not create, even touch you. You will have to go deep into your meditations. And then you can create a distance between you and your mind. Immediately you realize that your ego is false, and the moment you have seen it, it is dropped. The moment you are watching it, it is dropped. Not that you can drop it. Never do that foolishness, that talk that I am going to drop my ego. Instead, it is your seeing, your understanding and witnessing that ego drops on its own accord. Instead, in your seeing, understanding and witnessing, ego drops on its own accord.